Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for joining us at the DAC Pavilion stage. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Leon Stuck.
Okay, thanks. Thank everybody. Great afternoon. It's great to be back here in Las Vegas. I think my first DAC was in 1989. It was also actually in Las Vegas here. If we look over the last 30 years, I think I've presented about every stage here. I've never done a Sky Talk, so this is my first opportunity here. So today, I want to talk a little bit about quantum computing and kind of first give a little bit of a status. Where is quantum computing as we see it? What can EDA do to advance quantum computing going forward? And potentially, what could quantum computing do for us? Right? Could it help us solve some of our EDA problems? So before we get going here, let me give you a quick introduction to the IBM Q system that we introduced at the very early part of the year here. As you could see in the movie here, I mean, this is the first fully self-contained quantum computer. Right? Well, up to the beginning of this year, quantum computing could only take place in big labs. Yeah, this is a fully self-enclosed system that basically can do significant quantum computations. Also, what you saw in the video, this is enclosed in some really nice glassing here. Yeah, we actually worked with a company in Milan, Gopion, who also basically provides the glass that's being used to protect the crown jewels in London and the Mona Lisa in the Louvre. So this is very thick borosilicate glass. And not only does it look very pretty, but it also is really being used to protect the finicky qubits from the environment. Right? Temperature variations, variations, vibrations. As you will learn throughout the talk, these qubits are pretty delicate. So having this glass enclosing really helps us to boost significantly the performance of our quantum computer, as you will see throughout the talk. So let's look at the lower left here. You see a little chip here with the superconducting qubits and resonators. Going up there, that chip is mounted on a PCB, which has a good amount of extra shielding to make sure that we protect it from a lot of environmental variations. That board gets mounted right in the bottom of this big dilution refrigerator. And this is operating at about 15 millikelvin. So going up in the stack is mostly wiring to actually connect the chip and the PCBs to the control rack that's sitting outside here. So through that rack, temperature gradually rises, and by the time we get to the top, we pretty much get to room temperature, and the wiring feeds into the stack on the right here, which is basically the room temperature electronics that control the quantum computer, mostly by generating pulses and reading signals from the qubits. So how do you actually operate a quantum computer, a self-enclosed quantum computer? So right now, you can write some programs in Qiskit. This is a set of libraries that IBM has released. It's basically you run just on a classical computer. This compiles the program that you write in a type of quantum assembler, QASM, quantum assembler language, which basically runs on your classical computer and controls the control rack that you see on the side there. Well, in previous generations, this would be a huge stack of microwave generators that we kind of spread out all over your lab. For this fully enclosed system, we basically mapped that to one single rack of control by mostly putting all the key functions in the FPGAs and putting all the amplifiers in that network stack. Out of it comes a set of wiring. It basically goes into the refrigerator. First, signals go down, get attenuated, get connected into the quantum processor. Computation happens for about 100 milliseconds. And by that time, kind of the qubits run out. We'll get to that later. And then we go back up the stack. We try to amplify the signal, try to recognize what happened, goes into the control stack. It comes out and basically zeros and ones again. That gives you a digital representation of all the work that took place there. So what's in the chip? Yeah, well, there are different implementations of quantum chips. If you look at the one that IBM has, it's basically based on superconducting qubits, where we use Josephson junctions as nonlinear inductors. And they are kind of connected with the small microwave resonators, which are being used for two functions. It's one to kind of read out the qubits after they do the operations. And secondly, to basically connect two qubits to each other to create the entanglement that allows qubits to communicate to each other and actually stay entangled throughout some of their operations. So what makes a quantum computer so powerful? Kind of, and what is the magic behind quantum computing? So let's do a little bit of theory kind of on quantum computing and qubits. So a traditional bit basically is a zero or it's a one. And the same with a qubit. A qubit can take on a zero value pointing upwards on this sphere, or it can take on a one value pointing downwards. However, the interesting part of a qubit, it also can take a superposition of a zero and a one. So basically, it can take on any position on the sphere of this globe here. So one way to think about it is basically flipping a coin, right? When you're putting a coin and you turn it, you don't know if it's going to fall heads or tails. Right? So there's a period of time where it's basically both heads and tails. Right? It encodes a lot of states, and in the end it flips over, and then you know it's a one or it's a zero. Same thing with quantum computing. Yeah? So the qubit can take on all these different states, but when we measure the qubit, when we want to read it out, it needs to collapse back to a zero or a one. Okay? So the way we describe the fact that this qubit can go into these many superposition states is basically by a vector, yeah, where A and B can be complex numbers. It's basically any combination of zero and one that goes over the entire sphere here. So this is superposition. So of course, if you have more qubits, the power adds up very, very quickly. Yeah? Because one qubit basically can represent all these states by its state vector. If you have two qubits, we can combine these two state vectors together. If you have n qubits, we can basically combine the n qubits together. So very, very quickly, yeah, we get to two of these n complex terms for n qubits. So the amazing property of a quantum computer, that it has a ridiculously large compute space, state space, that it can describe with very, very, very few qubits. And this is very, very elementary to quantum computations. So that was the superposition part. The other part of the magic is what's called entanglement. And entanglement means that when you have two qubits, yeah, they cannot be described independently of each other. So if one is in a particular state, you know for sure that the other one is in a predictable other state. Yeah, not necessarily the exactly same state on the spheres, yeah, but one, if you know where the one is, you know where the other is. Again, I think a little bit about the coin flipping. Like you're flipping one coin, you're flipping two coins at the same time. So one is spinning, it ends up being heads. You know for sure the other one is going to be heads as well. Like, so even if the other one is not done spinning, you know for sure what it is. And this makes qubits extremely powerful to put very interesting algorithms on there that take full advantage of this type of entanglement. And I'll show you a couple of examples here. So how do you use this? How do you really get to programming a supercomputer? So let me try to explain you this pictorially a little bit. So if you look at the lines that go across the screen here, the first five lines are 5 qubits. So we're going to program a 5-qubit computer. Yeah? At the end, you see one line, which is actually a digital register. It's a digital bit. And at the very end, you see this little pink symbol here, which means we're going to measure. We're going to read out qubit 1. And we're going to represent that in a digital register C at the end, which is the end of the computation. So in this computation, there are single bit operations shown, which is basically an operation that's popped on the line. For example, you see the H gate there, which is the Hadamard gate. Yeah, very often used in quantum computation. What it does, it takes a qubit from its zero state, yeah, its rest state, and it flips it onto the equator. Yeah, so basically, equal probability of being a zero or a one. Correct? So when you read it out, it could flip either to a one or to a zero. So it's a single bit operation, which basically puts one of these qubits in the superposition state. And you see a couple of other ones, X, Y, Z. Basically, they all mess around with the face of a single qubit, yeah, and moves it around, around the globe. And then you see a 2-qubit operation there. Yeah, this is a C-NOT, controlled NOT gate. So this is a control signal, which is the little dot there, which is Q1, which controls basically what happens to Q2. So if the control bit is in zero state, nothing happens. And if it's in a one state, basically it flips over what happens to the Q2 bit. Yeah, so this is a 2-bit operation. So we need 2 qubits to actually be entangled to execute these type of operations. You can program this online. Yeah, you can basically go to the IBM Quantum Experience and either start to draw these type of diagrams here, or you can switch to a Quasim editor, which is basically a type of assembler language of quantum computing. So you're really writing down exactly what this circuit looks like, and it's like writing assembler code in the traditional type of compute systems. Okay, so remember, single bit operations, that basically puts qubits in superpositions, and 2-bit operations, like for example the C-NOT gate here, that really require entanglement between two types of qubits. So what is now really the power, and how can we describe the power of a quantum computer? And so the classical computers, we have gotten used to the idea, okay, if you double the number of transistors, so that you double the number of stuff that you throw on there, you kind of get potentially twice the amount of compute that you can get out of this. Right? At least for a while, this was somewhat true. So quantum computing has the potential, and the word potential is very important here, unfortunately, has the potential power to double its computational power every time you add a qubit. However, it does require perfect logical qubits for this to be true. And you basically need a perfect physical qubit that you can map one of these logical qubits onto. And right now, we're still very far away from having completely reliable qubits that are reliable for a long period of time. So what do you do when you have unreliable qubits? Because you do error correction, correct? We know that we have done error correction in digital electronics, analog electronics forever. Unfortunately, when you try to build a universal fault-tolerant quantum computing, correct, the holy grail of quantum computing, the currently known error correction algorithms are outrageously expensive. Yeah? So you need, and estimates vary, but the best known error correction algorithms for quantum computing, you probably need 1 to 5 million physical qubits to get one guaranteed good logical qubit. So we are pretty far away from that. Yeah? And therefore, algorithms that rely on perfect quantum computing for a long period of time, there's a while to come before we get there. However, a couple of years ago, people really got the notion of approximate quantum computers. Yeah? It's the intermediate scale quantum computer where you can do extremely interesting quantum computations with a quantum computer and qubits that are not necessarily perfect. Like, there's a significant class of algorithms that you can execute on non-perfect quantum computers, as long as they're good enough to kind of sustain the length of the computation. And that has kind of really created the big boost of energy in the last 5-6 years, and people say, hey, we can actually start to do pretty useful stuff with quantum computers, right? Because we don't have to wait for the universal quantum computer to be ready. So let me kind of show you a little bit how that works and what type of interesting things you can do there. So the first question, of course, is how powerful is a quantum computer that doesn't have perfect bits? Yeah? So we introduced kind of the notion of quantum volume. Yeah? And quantum volume tries to capture really a power of a quantum computing system. Yeah? So not necessarily the number of qubits that you have, but really the number of qubits, how they are connected, because we cannot create fully interconnected where every qubit can entangle with every other qubit. Basically, what gates they can perform, because sometimes we can have very complex logic qubits that need to kind of be decomposed, hey, technology mapping, yeah, to be mapped onto particular physical qubits that you only might have in your machine. And then, of course, you need to make sure that you put your computation on there so that can take place before the whole machine falls apart and you have to restart your computation because you run out of time, which is basically the decoherence and error times. So the interesting part of this quantum volume metric is, for example, if you have high error rates, adding qubits doesn't do you anything. Yeah, if you have a 100-qubit machine, and you have a very high error rate of 0.01, doubling the number of qubits doesn't do you any good for your quantum volume. On the opposite side, if you have a reasonable number of qubits, say 100, and you bring the error rate down from 1 in 100 to 1 in 1,000, you can actually increase the quantum volume by 24x without having to add any single qubit to this. Right? So the quality of your qubits really matters. And the quality of how you map your computation on your available hardware set and schedule it right significantly matters in the amount of quantum computation, the quantum volume of your machine, which you can actually execute on this piece of hardware. So IBM has started to actually publish our key numbers on our series of quantum computers. So very relevant metrics here are: at the very bottom is basically the single qubit error rate. Right? So you do a single bit operation, what's the chance that that single bit operation actually fails? And these are all in the order of 10 to the minus 3. Then there are the two qubit error rates, yeah, having to do with the entanglement. Unfortunately, they fail significantly more often. Right? They are in the 10 to the minus 2 type of error rates. You see kind of the best numbers in the rightmost column. And then there are two other very important metrics. It's basically is the relaxation time and the dephasing time. So relaxation is mean qubits love to be in their zero state. Yeah? So even if you put them in a one state, they might flip back. And the dephasing is when they are somewhere else around the globe, they also love to collapse back to zero or the one. Yeah? So important metric to keep in mind is basically this 100 here. Yeah. So you have about 100 milliseconds to do a quantum computation at our current machine, at the IBM Q System 1 that you saw in the class enclosing. And notice that both the Tokyo Poughkeepsie and IBM Q machines, they're all basically the same 20 qubit processor at its heart. Right? It's basically building a better system out of it. Yeah. Significantly allowed us to kind of bring down some of the error rates and improve the computations that can take place on these machines. So if you start to plot, yeah, this quantum volume on a curve, we had our 5-bit Tenerife machine in 2017. We had the 2018 20-bit machine, and we had the 2019 fully enclosed machine. We had a quantum volume of 4 on the Tenerife machine, a quantum volume of 8 on the Tokyo machine and 16 on the IBM, and a little bit over 16 on the IBM Q System 1. So we know this curve. Right? We know this curve. It looks very much like the curve that was published many, many years ago. It's basically started of the rise of our entire semiconductor industry here. So I think what we have seen in the progress in the last couple of years, that there are no fundamental things in the way to make a significant number of steps forward along this curve. Yeah? It doesn't mean that it's not a ridiculously, outrageously complex engineering problem, but there don't seem to be fundamental limitations why we can not take a couple of quick steps on this curve in the next 4 to 5 years. So where does that bring you then? Yeah. It starts to bring you into the realm where you get somewhere in a couple of hundred bits. Right? And there start to be very interesting algorithms in the domains of quantum chemistry, in optimization, in heuristic machine learning, that can actually execute on this type of quantum computers with an advantage versus conventional computers. Okay? So we are starting to potentially, in the next 5 years, get to that flipping point where there are certain computations, again, certain very specialized computations that can actually run with an advantage over conventional computing. And I think that kind of is behind some of the current excitement in the whole quantum computing domain here. I mean, certainly there are other algorithms out there, very famous algorithms like Schur's algorithm, for example, that fall more in this universal, fault-tolerant quantum computing domain that we will be very far away from before we get there. So the question to us in EDA, right, what can we do to walk faster up this curve? What can we do in the EDA with our EDA discipline knowledge to actually build faster quantum computers quicker? So let me kind of go through a couple of things that we have been working on, that other people in academia have been working on, to give you a little bit of an illustration of what has been done. And I'll also show you a little bit of the framework that we have set up that others can really jump in and contribute in various areas as well, even if you don't have a physical quantum computer sitting in your data center. So the first part, of course, is just make a better chip. Like make more qubits that have better error rates, that have more, allow for more entanglement between the qubits. So most of the simulation tools that we out there, microwave simulation tools, are actually pretty decent. So they're good enough. Most of the layout tools that we out there can certainly deal with 50, 60, 100 type of qubits. We probably need to tune them a little bit to come up and do a little bit broader exploration and try to understand a little bit what type of topologies create more noise between qubits than other topologies. There's more learning to be done there. And you can actually do some of that learning on the quantum computer itself. But I would say most of the conventional EDA tools are pretty good kind of to continue to build the chip there. But there are many other parts that go into the quantum volume that we can work on. As I said, there is, what about the connectivity between the qubits? Right? Well, you could love to have an all-to-all connectivity where you can put all these C0 gates, these 2-bit gates everywhere. Reality is we have few and far between. So the quantum volume really looks at the overall performance of a quantum computer. So think about the quantum volume as an extremely stress test where you run full out many, many quantum bits and you take into account how well the compiler has mapped this, what the topology is of your machine, what the error rate is of your machine, kind of in that, in the end, kind of calculate how long a computation that can take place there. So we can do a lot of things to kind of improve the type of computation that takes place on the quantum computer. So for example, these are some of the topologies of machines that we have out there. As it is certainly not a full by full connected matrix. You can see all the error rates between each of the qubits. And certainly when you're mapping operations, You want to put them at places where error rates are low. You want to put pieces later in the computation at places where the computation can last a little bit longer because the bits flip less likely back. So there's interesting work to be done, kind of, which is mostly technology mapping, it's almost FPGA-like placement, routing, fixed topology, under a whole set of constraints to put this back together. So let's walk to kind of one of the steps here, how you actually map a quantum algorithm. Right, so on the left side, we have a simple quantum algorithm, 5 C0 gates that need to be mapped on part of our 16-bit quantum computer, the left part here. So we have 6 physical qubits, and we have a small program that we try to map there. So we make an assignment of logic bits to physical bits. So you see logic bits, Q0 to Q5, mapped to Q0 to 3 and 14 and 15, because I cut off the bits on the remainder of the machine, because they're not connected, they are too far out, you don't want to move the bits too far to get to that part of the computation. So the first mapping is quite simple. We need entanglement between Q2 and Q3. We happen to have Q2 to Q3 available there, so we can map the gate, place it right there. The next one, we need entanglement from Q1 to Q0. Unfortunately, the entanglement goes the wrong way, right? Because the error between Q1 and Q0 points in the wrong direction. However, there is a solution for this. You can actually invert the entanglement by applying a whole bunch of Hadamard gates, do the entanglement the other way, and then flip everything back. The unfortunate thing is, this takes up a lot of compute power, right? You use 5 operations, you use 2-3 slots of time to actually do only a single operation. So you lose out. The next one, we need to entangle Q1 with Q4. So Q1 is sitting right now in Q1, and Q4 is sitting in Q14. So we need to basically find a path from Q1 to Q14 to entangle them. Another interesting operation we have are swap operations. So you can actually move qubits by just swapping them around. So we can swap Q1 and Q2, we can swap Q2 and Q3, and then we can use the connection between Q3 and Q14 basically to put the bit there. Same thing between the next operation, Q5 to Q14. We map this gate, we'll find a path from one to the other, we make the necessary swaps, and finally we can place the computation. And then we get to the last one. We need to make a few more swaps in the corner here, and we're basically putting this computation together. So final result is, it takes 15 operations, and it takes actually 12 slots to execute this computation. However, if you do it a little bit smarter, you can do this significantly better. By just doing better mapping and have a different assignment from the logical qubits to the physical qubits, you can actually show that you can do this in 7 time slots and in 11 operations. And there's some nice papers out there, actually. One of the winners this morning over the Under 40 Award, sitting right behind you, Patrick, did some of the work here on the compiler here. And actually, it's generally a good place to work on quantum computing, because we had actually 2 people working on quantum computing in the Under 40 session this morning. So if no other reason, that's a good reason to get into this. But I'll give you a few more reasons. Okay, so now we know how to kind of compile a quantum computer. How can we go work on this? So what IBM did, we put this together, this QISKit programming framework. So at the lowest level is basically the Terra level, which connects your programs to the actual hardware. So we have our hardware plugged in, other people can put other hardware in there, and you can actually write your own compilers. You can write your own compilers, your own schedulers, and make them smarter. And put that in the Terra layer of the framework. Then there is the Air layer. In the Air layer, you can provide other simulators, okay? Because there are a lot of quantum simulators where you can actually run quantum simulation up to, around 40, 50 bits, qubits type of simulations on high performance computing clouds. So people can plug in their own simulators in this type of framework. And then there's the Aqua layer, where people have started to write libraries for interesting optimization algorithms, interesting machine learning algorithms, and we show a few examples there. And then the last, a very recent piece here, is basically the QISKit Ignis layer, where you actually can go into the hardware and apply a lot of measurements. So you can actually take some artificial or benchmark type of circuits, run them through the Ignis layer, play with the pulses, understand the errors rates between the individual bits, look at the cohesion times, and you can actually find all these things out, read them out, and try to calibrate actually your compute, because as I said, you want to actually compile your circuits so that they run on the best part of the quantum computer to be able to have the longest benefit of the qubits. Yeah. So the Ignis framework basically gives you a lot of APIs to actually start to probe and test, yeah, and calibrate a quantum computer. So I think people working in test, it's actually a very interesting interface where we can start to take some of the knowledge from the EDA domain and start to apply this. Now, overall, the Qiskit has seen significant uptick. Yeah, we have a lot of people have started to download it, have started to run it. We have people that run experiments on our quantum chips, that's shown in blue. Yeah, we have people that run on quantum simulators. Except for Antarctica, I think we have most continents covered by now. And people have started to build interesting modules kind of on top of the base level type of the stack here. Yeah, so you can go to quizkids.org and basically start to play and add in there. Yeah, me being from the Netherlands, a tiny country, it's good, at least we still show up on the chart here. Yeah. But there are some interesting countries that actually run significantly large number of simulations. Yeah. So I think the net is that there are quite a few interesting problems that we can take our EDA knowledge and optimization and experience and actually start to apply it to quantum computing and maybe accelerate the march up and make quantum computers better. So the next question is, can quantum computers do actually something for us in the EDA space? Right. Do we have enough interesting algorithms that are kind of in this blue space, yeah, where we believe quantum computers have an advantage and where we can start to solve EDA problems significantly better than we currently can? And so this is, now I'm getting to the sky portion of the talk, correct? So whatever I say now is partially having seen some other domains that have found interesting models. Yeah, partially having lived 30 years of EDA optimization, starting to see some parallels, and then a lot of speculation and hope, okay? But I think there are some really interesting algorithms that emerged over the last 6 months that look very similar to stuff that we try to do in the EDA space, and where we start to really need to think and learn how to potentially think quantum, right? One of the stickers that we have in IBM, and people say, I cannot, it's like, you're thinking too classical. It really requires a completely different way of thinking about algorithms. So let me give you a few examples. Yeah. One is very simple, Monte Carlo analysis. We do this a lot, correct, to find rare events in tons of simulations. Yeah, so there's one paper that came out of our Zurich lab in the beginning of the year, where normally, yeah, Monte Carlo simulation basically is 1 over the square root of the number of samples that you take, yeah, is what you need. So you can reduce that on the quantum computer to 1 over the number of samples. Right, so basically giving you a quadratic speed up in basically the number of Monte Carlo simulations that you need to take here. So I think an interesting, yeah, early type of algorithm there. So how do you need to kind of think about quantum and quantum algorithms? And I don't think that's a good way to describe it, but at least there is some intuition there. Yeah? So you need to look at your problem and create a ridiculously large state space out of it. Okay? Because you want to use the superposition of all of the 2 to the n states that a quantum computer can represent. Yeah? So instead of our kind of classic thinking where we do branch and bound and try to cut off every side path as soon as possible and run down to one very small local minima, you want to think ridiculously broad. Yeah? You don't need to be perfectly accurate, but you want to have a state space representation of your problem. Right? So that you basically encode into your quantum computing by putting all these quantum bits into superpositions. Right? So you see a lot of Hadamard gates at the beginning of your quantum compute. Then you apply an algorithm that entangles a certain amount of them, yeah, which is really the core of your computation. And then the magic happens. It collapses to a very few states that you can read out, and you have your solution. Yeah. And I know this sounds like an enormous amount of magic, and it kind of it is. But when I started to read this paper on, this was published in Nature of March of this year, and it's actually a very, very well-written paper, yeah, where they really take machine learning classification algorithm and map it onto a quantum computer. Yeah. And basically take full advantage of the large state space that you can represent, have a relatively simple computation, entangle the bits, and basically get a very good predictor out there, yeah, that decides if yeah, if one of these dots is black or if it's gold. Basically, very simple classification problem. Yeah. This was done on basically 2 qubits of a 5-qubit machine. Yeah. So again, it was a relatively simple example, but it shows that you can start to run and think about a very different class of algorithm on the quantum computer. Yeah, you wait, you do that. Yeah, and this, you can actually go and look at the actual code. It's published. It's also part of the Qiskit. It has a machine learning library there. But many of the quantum algorithms look like this. Yeah, phase zero, you prepare it in quantum position, you try to map your state space. Phase one, you do the entanglement, you iterate, you train. And then finally, you're able to measure and collapse it to your 0 and 1 bits. So is this readily usable? Certainly not. But I think there is a certain set of optimization algorithms, a certain set of machine learning algorithms, very analogous to the stuff that we do in EDA all the time that have equivalents in quantum. I've seen described like quantum annealing, correct? Which is not like using the full power of a quantum computer, because you mostly use the superposition. You don't use the full entanglement. And that allows you basically to tunnel out of local minima. So if you're stuck in a local minima, you don't have to climb all the way up. You can get into another local minima by just tunneling through. That's my simplest explanation. Right? My hope, my speculation is that using the full power of a quantum computer, you kind of hover above your solution space. Yeah, not necessarily with the full detailed accuracy, but there's enough accuracy that you can find a good spot to land, and then use classical algorithms to go down and basically solve your problem again. And I think that's what we'll see in the future for a long time to come. Right? Quantum computers will not be standalone machines. Yeah? They will be accelerators for interesting parts of very hard algorithms, where they certainly can explore a very different part of the state space than the classic algorithms can. Yeah, so the trick is, how do you divide up your algorithms between one and the other? How do you really start to understand what type of algorithms you can actually run and prepare? So where we believe in IBM is kind of that we are sort of halfway between quantum ready and getting to quantum advantage. In fact, there's enough hardware out there, there are enough toolkits out there, there are some interesting examples of algorithms, and there is a pretty decent roadmap to improve the number of qubits and the quality and the quantum volume of the machines that we out there. So it's really time for people to get engaged, because it is extremely difficult to start to think differently and start quantum algorithms. But I think there's enough out there to start to experiment and play. That's why I'm pretty excited. And hopefully get ready for the time when quantum computers, yeah, can really actually deliver an advantage. Okay, to probe further, here are a couple of links. But just search for IBM Q or Qiskit or IBM Q Experience in any of your search engines, and you'll be able to find this quickly, or just take your picture and you'll have it as well. Okay, thank you very much. I'm not sure when we have to get off this stage, but I'll be happy to take questions or hang out here and answer questions. Yeah, but you have to come up here because I have no way to hear you otherwise, I think. Yeah, unless there's a mic here.
So you gave the time for the Hadamard gate.
Yes. So the question is, you have 100 milliseconds kind of to do your computation. Actually, the 100 milliseconds is sort of when two qubits lose their entanglement, right? So the answer to the question is unfortunately quite complicated, because if you schedule your entanglements right, you kind of can chain your computations together, right? So you can start on one part of the machine, move to the other part of the machine. If you are able to put the right swaps in between that don't create too much noise on your other bits, you can actually get quite a bit of compute done. Yeah. So that's why there's so much room for compiler optimization in this. And it also depends on the topology of your machine. Right? So depending on if you have a very long machine, very narrow, or if you have a fully more densely connected matrix. So again, that's another active field of research. What is actually a good topology of a machine, given that you can only have relatively few connections in between there, and how would you develop kind of the next chip that has a good topology? So there's no single answer. It's basically the whole interplay in there, and the quantum volume basically allow the quantum volume benchmark circuits allow you to basically run iteratively larger circuits till they fall apart. Right, so that's the best way to try it out. Okay, thanks everybody. Have a great DAC.